Good afternoon. My name is Christopher Rausch. I'm currently a PhD student conducting research at Drexel University's College of Computing and Informatics. Today, I'm going to talk about a particular type of persistent identifier known as the archival resource key and how it might contribute to the field of computational archival science. In the paper I'm discussing, we looked at how persistent identifiers in the ARC format could help enhance the computational readiness of a class of archival resource with a specific focus, and that's the ontology. When we refer to ontologies in this work, it's a type of classification scheme created by experts as a means to aid in finding resources and to help describe them. Here is the contact information of the other authors of the paper, most of whom will be available to participate in the Q&A following my brief presentation. I am sure that you'll find that each of the contributors is quite familiar with the topics they've contributed, and there will be time at the end for a question and answer session with everyone. This type of classification is useful in computation because it organizes data into categories that can then be manipulated through various types of data structures and programming paradigms. We focus on a particular type of widely used standard, the Library of Congress subject headings. And the LCSH has been actively maintained since 1898, and it represents what is considered an authoritative cataloging structure for the library and for many other institutions that have adopted it. Because the LCSH is actively maintained, it naturally changes over time. That is to say that the group of subject heading entries in the contemporary catalog is necessarily different from the one that existed 100 or so years ago. Researchers have found that analyzing a work in the context of the categorizations recognized at the time it was produced can provide helpful insights into a variety of analyses. So what is an ARC? The ARC specification is an IETF draft standard, which can be found on that organization's data tracker. More information, including common implementation scenarios and frequently asked questions, is available in the online community ARCs in the Open. That's listed in the resource slide at the end of the presentation. To the definition, ARCs are high-functioning identifiers that provide references and descriptions for objects of any type. One characteristic that distinguishes the ARC from many other types of persistent identifiers is that ideally it carries with it access not only to the metadata of the object it describes, which is in our case the 1910 LCSH and its constituent terms, but also an institutional commitment to stewardship. This is an important concept because technical means alone are not enough to ensure persistence. It is important that the publisher of the information object, the one that mints and advertises the ARC, is ready and willing to dedicate the necessary resources to persistence over time, as well as to engage in succession planning. I know this is a busy slide, so I'll leave it up for a bit longer. An ARC identifier is generally carried in a URI and shares some of the structure of a URI. It can begin with a name mapping authority, or in URI terms, a host name, that could in practice indicate the service that will return the payload of data. But the core immutable identity of the ARC is actually independent of any host name. In the information retrieval sense, the name assigning authority could represent an institution. You can see from this image that the base object name is composed of the label to signify the ARC, ARC colon slash, a name assigned authority number called a NAN for short, and an assigned name. The ARC supports what are called shared NANs to permit leveraging certain immutable semantics. This example you'll see, 99152, is the NAN for terms. There is an intentional flexibility in the structure because the information object could be labeled differently, as in 13183, which is the NAN for the Metadata Research Center here at Drexel University. In this way, the ARC format does not prescribe a strict metadata or ontological structure, instead leaving it to the publisher to imagine the most appropriate format to conceptually express the resource. In this study, we chose to use a shared NAN for terms because the objects we're representing are very clearly terms that are bound together with intent. The digitization and data preparation process was a joint effort between the Metadata Research Center and Temple's Digital Libraries, and we are publishing the intellectual output of the Library of Congress cataloging experts. Therefore, it makes more sense to assign a general NAN to the information object. Of course, generally, only one institution will host this specific copy of the digital version of the subject headings, but that could change over time. This is one reason opaqueness is encouraged in the format of the ARC. Opaqueness in the sense that the format does not obviously express semantic cues for things such as institutions that are mutable. If the format is opaque, how then is the ARC resolved? In this case, there will always be a means somewhere to determine who is responsible for a particular resource. Here, this is represented by a shoulder, B4. This is a conceptual categorization that indicates that the associated information object is the responsibility of Drexel University's Metadata Research Center, and that it is categorized as a subject vocabulary. Is this the best way to do it? We think so, but say, for example, another institution would have the same vocabulary available as an electronic resource, it might characterize the object differently. Which characterization taken on would ideally depend on its usefulness and also on the reputation of the publisher. A more detailed discussion of this distinction is a topic for an upcoming paper. By convention, the shoulder is not separated from the rest of the object identifier. Take a look at the FAQ for shoulders to see a more detailed explanation of why. The link is in the resource slide. We chose 1910 as the suffix to this object identifier, even though it's not ideally opaque. We chose it for experimentation so that it might more easily be programmatically accessed and switched for what the Library of Congress considers to be the same object, but a later version. The penultimate component in the diagram is the randomly generated unique ID for the term. In the context of the entire ARC, it is unique. The last digit is a check digit, which is helpful in detecting transcription errors. There is no required process for minting an ARC, but there is a helpful utility. The last portion of the ARC indicates an inflection or qualifier. The representation here, the question mark, should return some metadata associated with the information object. In addition, qualifiers can be appended for a variety of interesting results. I'll show some examples near the end of the presentation. You can find the package at CPAN. It will mint the ARCs for you and put them in a Berkeley database. It's further useful as an aid to resolving ARCs for servers at a particular hostname, and it has hooks that make it easy to integrate with a web server. What is the role of a resolver? N2T, or Names to Things, is a resolver service that has partnerships with identifiers.org, archive.org, and other providers of persistent identifiers. In the context of an ARC, the main purpose is to register a NAN and to provide instructions for resolution. The implementation details of institutional resolvers are outside the scope of this paper, but this service is what allowed us to affiliate B4 with our server at Drexel University. From a registry, the resolver knows where to forward the request, and in our case, it's to an endpoint that has a vocabulary server waiting to receive it. This is where we have Hive. It's a linked data automatic indexing metadata application. Hive can use existing ontologies and automatically generate well-formed standardized metadata. So you see how it could be useful not only to resolve an ARC to a particular vocabulary term, but also to provide generic services against it. The University of North Texas has taken this idea to a higher level. Because of the flexibility of the ARC and the responsibility assigned to the publishing institution, there are any number of permutations that can be derived from an ARC. For example, the ARC might contain a qualifier that returns a thumbnail image of the archived object. The ARC might cause the server to respond with a specific data type. It may even be the endpoint for a service. There's a link to a slideshow in the resources that shows many of the possibilities, and this resource is notably referred to using an ARC. For this project, we focused on the specific topic of historical ontologies. The nature of terms metadata may not call for the extensive manipulation demonstrated by UNT, but there are useful things that can be done. For example, one of the challenges of preparing the LCSH 1910 was in optical character recognition. certain anomalies consistently arose, such as the confusion of entity recognition for terms containing M dashes. This sounds like a small problem, but it's common, and there are many others like it. We'd also be interested in hearing any other suggestions for the next steps we might take.